Hello everyone, welcome to Praise the Run. Welcome to episode 9. I'm Ben Benjamin Lucky, also the Mr. Ben Show. This is Patrick.
I'm Patrick.
Patrick. also later died.
That's me.
Yeah, Patrick, what's up?
Oh man, so much. I literally just I literally just found out I don't have to download Scorn because it's cloud play only
on
my Xbox. So I literally just clicked it and now it's on the menu. It'll probably be off by the time this is done, but
dope.
I'm playing it.
We're coming in with great energy.
Literally the day it came out.
Yeah.
Today.
Yeah, it just
I'm
came
slamming.
Out. Well, that's the first news story, I guess, that's out of the way. It's not really much other than that. Scorn's out today. Along with there was something else that came out today. Oh, that Dragon Ball game came out today. The one that's like a basically Dead by Daylight. You play as a normal non-superhero characters hiding away from a big baddie like Vegeta or fucking other Dragon Ball villains.
Right.
Whatever. I'm not a huge Dragon Ball fan, but I thought that was interesting.
You like level up though? You become a Dragon Ball guy?
No.
No? Oh,
no.
Okay.
It's the Dead by Daylight thing where
you're just constantly
trying to escape.
That's cool, though, I guess.
Yeah.
I mean, that has its own...
Yeah, you're playing as, like, Bulma.
Area.
And,
yeah,
like,
yeah.
The pig dude and...
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
He's
characters
cool.
That don't have weapons or characters.
Right.
Yeah, I guess it's cool. What a great energy to start out the podcast with. That I was not expecting to start off with that. I was asking what you were playing.
Oh, that's
not
literally
what you were downloading.
It's literally what I played for 2 minutes before I ran down the stairs.
But
I'm playing it right now.
Get that.
I
off
can
the
also
list.
Answer that though. on top of that, I'm down. I thought I was gonna be playing Persona 5, but Xbox fooled me and was like, "You can just download it a week early." So.
Yeah, it's next week.
Though I could have been playing it the whole time because you own all of that, but...
Yeah, I have,
you know,
at least Persona 5.
I'm picky.
But they did announce recently, actually, I didn't have that as a news story, that Persona 3 Portable and Persona 4 Golden are also coming.
Nice.
Now, well, they did announce that they were coming, but now they have a date. It is Persona 3, what else are you playing while I pull this up?
I'm trying to play the new Overwatch. A super weird thing happened to me a couple days in a row where, like, everything's out of focus. Like, my character isn't wearing glasses. Because, like, my gun is in focus, but everything else isn't. It's the weirdest thing I've ever experienced in a game. And it made me, like, actually sick, so I had to put it down. It's fine now. I played it, like, a little bit this morning, and it works. It's just weird, like, some of the things that happen. And then I'm still doing Elden Ring. I just picked that back up.
Yes.
And, of course, Rocket League.
Yes.
And they just had an update to... So did Elden Ring. I just had to update that this morning.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
They had a new patch.
I gotta do that, too. Yeah, there's, actually, I don't know what the news is on that either, so I'm gonna pull that up. Because there was news that came out about that.
I didn't read all of it. The only thing that caught my eye was that a lot of the magic stuff got like a boost in attack, which is great for me because that's pretty much mostly what I do is just use the, you know, I stand back and shoot the little blue, you know, bombs or whatever.
Yeah.
So, great for me. Really might help me get through this game a little faster, maybe. I don't know.
Hell yeah. January 19th, 2023 is when 3 and 4 come to Game Pass and Switch and all of that.
Mm.
Now that I have that. Elden Ring, I have also been playing.
Yeah.
Got a couple hours in this week. I beat Farum Azula.
Nice.
And Malekith the Black Blade. And I am now back at the top of the tree.
Nice.
Or not the top of the tree, but the throne before the tree.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I have finally done my duty in becoming an Elden Lord.
Hell yeah.
So I'm about to start that next part, but I just...
And get crowned?
Yeah. No, it won't, no. You get to the throne, and there's another boss there.
Oh, well, of course. So,
That boss is the boss I was talking about last time, where we were talking about how Souls games like put things in
to hint to other things.
Yeah, to hint to other games that they're working on and stuff. That's this boss. He has a phase where he like rips off all of his armor and goes like full Street Fighter and starts like fighting with his hands.
That's
and,
interesting,
like,
yeah.
Grappling you and stuff. He has a super weird cadence, which I was not expecting. But it was cool. I got to see that phase because you take down all of his health or close to all of his health, and then it hits that phase, and then he just completely gets a new health bar.
Oh, yeah.
And you're like, oh shit. Okay. But yeah, that was really cool. I had fought him, I guess, beforehand as an apparition, which is a hint. Yeah, I'm really excited to continue on with that. I've been playing a little bit more Outlast
because of the Halloween season. Spooky season, yeah, of course.
So replaying through Outlast 1 can get to Whistleblower. And then I can play Outlast 2, which I have not played a lot of.
No.
I played, like, the first 3 hours or so.
Oh, nice.
Of Outlast 2, but, like...
So it's still, like, there's still, like, stuff that's...
Yeah.
New scares.
Yeah, that's gonna be down the road, though. So, I think... I just finished Traeger's part, which is the Doctor.
Yeah.
Which I think is, like, halfway-ish through the game. I'm about to get into the next, like, scary part before it turns, like, weird sci-fi ghost stuff.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, that's really all I've been playing. Elden Ring is the big thing. I'm actually going to play Elden Ring right after this.
I
just edited Elden Ring episode 2.
Heck yeah.
I'm probably
gonna play a little bit of that, too. Oh!
That's up to it.
Spooky games.
Yes.
I've been playing the Resident Evil Biohazard.
Oh, 7?
Yeah.
7's really good.
Played a little bit of that last night, actually. So I was like, I need at least one spooky game.
So have you played any of the originals? Or anything like that?
I mean, I played, like, the first 3 back in the day, like, PlayStation 1.
Okay.
I have the director's cut up there, but,
I just want to know if you had a frame of reference for Resident Evil and how different.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Versus... Yeah, yeah, for sure.
Okay.
Definitely. Yeah. It's definitely one. Completely, because you're just first running person. Laps in that house and shit and like.
Yeah.
Yeah, first person. And there's not a lot of like. Or there's no like. Extra enemies, I guess. It's just everyone is like a main character.
No, that's not true.
No,
that's not true.
Oh, well, I haven't... So far, I haven't encountered anyone that isn't, like, a part of the house and stuff.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah, so you definitely have your big cutscenes, but you'll have a handful of smaller enemies, like, in there.
Oh, okay. Well, because, like, the first Resident Evil, like, you know, you just encounter zombies. Yeah. It's just, like, zombies scattered.
It's not, like, multiple types of zombies and crawlers. I mean, they're variations on those things, but it's not as dense as what a Resident Evil already, especially the remakes where it's like a hallway full of zombies. There's not a lot of that. Kind of. Anyways, yeah, that's cool. 7's really good. I played through 7 on the channel a while ago.
Yeah.
And I played through 8 last year. Nice. I'm really excited because the DLC for 8 comes out soon. You can replay the whole game of 8 and third person. And the DLC is Ethan's daughter. And she has, like, it's supposed to be, like, a psychological horror thing. But that's also going to be in third person as well.
Nice.
Which is interesting because 8 is also in first person game. Yeah, I'm really excited for that. What else? Yeah, Scorn was the other thing I'm really excited for. Scorn's out today, so I probably will play Scorn at some point. It's just on the list of things that I need to play.
Right, of course.
On top of things that I want to play and all of the old shit. So it's just going to be on the list. I play horror games all the time, so
right.
It's not like I'm reserved for this thing or for Halloween. But I only play games when I'm recording, so it's not like I'm playing a bunch of games in my free time or anything like that.
Right.
Yeah,
you have to schedule it out.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. But yeah, that's all I got for playing. Nothing's really new in my life other than just working all the time and stuff like that. So we can get straight into the news. We missed a couple things last week that I thought were interesting to bring up, at least this week, because it's kind of... The first one I have here is... I think everyone's on board with how dumb this is. Horizon Zero Dawn is getting a remaster. This is an IGN article from Adam Bankhurst. Horizon Zero Dawn PS5 remaster reportedly in the works alongside a multiplayer game. A remaster of 2017's Horizon Zero Dawn in the works for PS5 alongside a brand new multiplayer game for PS5 and PC. As reported by VGC and MP1 First, The Last of Us Part 1 remake, in which previously worked, was worth... Basically what this article is saying is that a PS5 remaster is coming into, is Forbidden West, but...
Trying to, like, GTA 5 it and just keep remastering it.
Well, so, the game didn't have a PS... It didn't have a remaster. This game... Horizon Zero Dawn is a PS4 game that came out in 2017.
Right.
So they want a remaster for the PS5.
Okay, so this is the first remaster.
Yes. The PS4 game, Horizon Forbidden West, is an okay looking game. It's a good looking game. It's not... the graphics look great.
Yeah.
When the PS5 launched, they did like a PS5 upgrade kind of thing.
Okay.
For it. Like, gave it 4K resolution, unlocked frame rates and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So you can buy that PS4 game, and I think it's free. If you buy the game or whatever, but you get an upgrade with it. This would be a $70 remaster of that game.
Yeah.
And the DLC. But I don't think it would be a remaster. I think it's just going to be a repackaging with that PS5 update already installed into it. But this is still reports and rumors as of now. It's not like 100% confirmed yet, but... When VGC puts out an article, hey, this is in the works, you're more inclined to believe it.
Right.
So, and there's not really much to say. This news has been out for a week already, but it's just not a good idea.
Yeah.
But it's not for people that have played that game. It's for people that are going to be playing that game on their new PS5s.
Mm.
When the show comes out.
Right.
Because there's also a Netflix show coming out of Horizon.
Okay.
And that's supposed to come out next year. So,
that's interesting.
Yeah, I would assume they want to line it up with that.
Yeah.
Just like they did with Last of Us Part 1. You know, release the game on PS5, so when the show comes out... The show's not out yet, but when the show comes out, the game gets a huge boom. That happened with The Witcher. That happened with Cyberpunk.
Yeah.
Like, we've seen these things.
Yeah, there's a model now.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Other news, I can just bring up a video of theirs, just because that's easy, and play in the background while we talk over, the, doop-a-doop-a-doop-a-doop. Giant Bomb, GameSpot, Metacritic, and more sold to FanWiki Company. The former CNET sites are now... Turn that down on these headphones so I'm not distracted. The former CNET sites are now owned by the people who bring you Wikipedia. By John Walker, this is Kotaku. The gaming press world has been in quite some turmoil as of late. Tencent just gutted Fanbyte, G4 TV just fired a bunch of its staff, and Future Publishing just let go a swath of writers and editors, despite making hundreds of million dollars last year. So it's with perhaps some trepidation with we report that the news that Fandom, the wiki hosting company, has just bought behemoths including GameSpot, Metacritic, and Giant Bomb. And included in that list is GameFAQs, Cord Cutter News, Comic Vine, TV Guide. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, so Fandom just bought a bunch of people in the games industry. And of course, that's exciting. Especially for me being a huge fan of Giant Bomb.
Right.
That is exciting. They were bought by Red Ventures about 2 years ago. That bought them from CNET. And Red Ventures was, they weren't bad or anything. They just didn't know what to do with any of these video game company writers. Or video game journalists, media. But they weren't, like, firing people or anything like that. They were just, like, you know, doing their thing. Actually, GameSpot did have a couple of layoffs last year as well. But the Fandom buying them, I don't know, it's exciting. Fandom's a pretty big website. They have funding and stuff like that.
Yeah.
They could keep these guys afloat. There's just a lot of back-end stuff that people would think are could see as redundant.
Right.
Giant Bomb, along with being famous for their personalities and lives in the video game media and stuff like that, they have an extensive wiki that people have been using for years.
Oh, really?
Just, like, catalogs of, like, video game items, characters, like, games, game news, like...
Oh, interesting.
Reports, like, quotes, like, extensive video game media, on the verge of, like, stuff that, like, the Video Game History Foundation would have and stuff, like, super, super detailed stuff that Fandom definitely doesn't have. And then you have GameFAQs, where it has all of, like... GameFAQs has been around since the 90s. And they've been... I mean, that's where, like, any retro guide that I pull up, I go to GameFAQs, because that's where all it used to live.
Right.
And GameFAQs is still running, and it's still... They're still publishing guides and stuff like that. It's more like a forum. It's all text-based stuff. It's all... There's not pictures or anything like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. TV Guide was a weird one, but it's a... I get it. I mean, it's another thing. It's another cataloging
thing. Why not? Yeah, it's yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting. GameSpot as well. GameSpot, another video game media thing. But they're definitely different than Giant Bomb. Giant Bomb is very personality-based with the 9 core members.
Mm-hmm.
Well, GameSpot is reviews, editorials, like, articles.
It's pretty much from anyone.
Yeah.
Anyone who writes it.
Yeah, exactly. They hire freelance writers and stuff like that.
Right.
I mean, there's definitely core people that are there, and there's core people that are at GameSpot that are part of Giant Bomb, because they've always been sister companies, basically. It's just interesting. It's, I'm excited for the future of Giant Bomb. People leaving Giant Bomb was always sad. A lot of people have left. All of the original people are pretty much gone.
Right. And I mean, that's gonna happen.
Yeah. But it's nice to see that the team is thriving and they have a new life breathed into them.
Oh, for sure.
And people that are excited to be a part of Giant Bomb. And not just people who have been there for a long time and feel like they still need to be a part of something, even though they want to do something else. Whether if that something else is the same thing in just a different place or not.
Right.
Which is what all of the main guys went on to do. I mean, Vinny, Brad, and Alex are Nextlander now. Jeff is doing his own podcast thing. Everybody's still in games media. It's just they're all doing their own thing, and Giant Bomb can continue on doing Giant Bomb and being great, and I really hope fandom gives especially Giant Bomb the funding and the breath and the life the that it deserves. The creative freedom. Yeah, because these group of people is it's something special.
Yeah.
Especially in video games media. It's like the Allies, except the Allies are kind of funny, or they're not owned by anyone. They're independent. They have Patreons and stuff like
that. Right, they're just YouTubers who have established themselves.
Giant Bomb is not that.
Right.
Because they're owned by somebody, so they're kind of at the whims of suits that don't necessarily understand this form of media. But now, being owned by fandom, that's it's a little bit different, because fandom has its own video games articles and stuff like that. I mean, anyways, that's that story. that was also last week, so catching up on things I forgot. More recent news, do you want to go with bad news or good news?
Let's start with the bad news.
Okay. So this is heavy. Another Activision Blizzard worker files sexual harassment lawsuit.
Oh.
The suit alleges gender discrimination, battery, and revenge porn. This is by Nicole Carpenter over at Polygon. Another Activision Blizzard employee is alleging in a new lawsuit that the company failed to prevent sexual harassment and discrimination in the workplace. The complaint filed last week in the Los Angeles Superior Court details alleged repeated sexual advances and harassment from an Activision Blizzard manager who is also named as a defendant in the lawsuit, as well as revenge porn and sexual battery. Daily Mail first reported the lawsuit. The Activision Blizzard employee, who is named as Jane Doe in the court documents, detailed her experience with manager Miguel Vega throughout the 24-page complaint. She is represented by high-profile lawyer Lisa Bloom, who said Tuesday on Twitter that her firm, the Bloom Firm, is representing 8 women with sexual harassment claims against Activision Blizzard. Bloom held a press conference in December after filing a lawsuit on behalf of a worker named Christine. Bloom has said each of these 8 women will file their own individual lawsuits to make sure that they're fairly compensated, according to .LA. So, this story is, of course, awful, and this shit has been going on in Activision Blizzard for a while now.
Yeah. They're recruiting all the freaks.
Yeah, and it's been like that for so long, and you have people at the top that enable shitty people, and those shitty people rise to the top and create shitty work culture, and it makes it harder for the rest of the normal crew who actually matter in making these games, and like
the actual blood,
the actual life of of the studio. It makes it so, like, people question, like, working in games is a dream job for people, you know? And, like, this kind of shit is, like...
not a dream.
No. It's unwelcoming. It's toxic. Activision is very toxic. But there's good people at Activision still. There's still good studios at Activision still. Like, Toys for Bob seems so separated from all of this, versus, like, the big Blizzard stuff. I mean, not just, like, I mean, you have the, all of this horrible sexual harassment stuff, but also the games that are coming out under the Activision Blizzard label are being received very poorly now.
Yeah.
When they used to be out. On top, Overwatch 2 is going through shit.
Right, that's what I was saying.
The Diablo Immortal thing.
They're a wreck.
Yeah, you had Warcraft 3 Reforged or whatever. That horrible launch.
Yeah.
It's just taking hit after hit. But on top of this, this is... the reason why this is important, why they specifically said that each of these individual women will be filing their own claims... is because of... there's already several lawsuits against Activision Blizzard in the workplace right now.
Yeah.
Including being sued by the state of California itself.
Oh, wow.
And that whole thing has been going on for the better part of a year.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And... because of all of the corporate lawyers and hands in that pot, it's basically been at arm's length and kind of, I don't know, muddled.
Yeah.
It doesn't have the traction that it had at the beginning, and, like, it's still very up in the air and flimsy and stuff. So these women are being directly represented. This is their case. We're going to make an example out of Activision Blizzard with individual court settlements.
Case by case.
Versus a collective of these 25 individuals all in one group trying to sue.
No one's getting buried in the...
and that case gets involved with the other case that's getting things. So now... those individuals are now part of the California case, and because that California case is going nowhere, and that's a whole, like, workplace culture by the state versus an individual workplace violations and stuff like that.
Yeah.
That this will be a separate thing and intentionally separate to make a stand.
Good.
Yes. Excellent. Yeah, I mean, there's 1,000 things that will make this better. Ripping out all the shitty people unionizing for workplace culture, and making demands and stuff like that. We've definitely had the Activision Blizzard employees make demands to the higher-ups and stuff like that, and the higher-ups just sweeping it under the rug. Activision Blizzard have said since then, they're not going to deny unions, but they're not going to involve, like, setting up unions, basically. They're, right. like, basically, like, if you guys want to unionize and vote to unionize, you can.
Yeah, do it amongst yourselves.
Yeah, but we want you to vote, and it has to be, like, a unanimous vote, and it was, like, this whole bullshit. And then, with the Xbox buying Activision thing, Phil Spencer was like, yeah, unionize, we don't care.
Right.
Unionizing brings us to the next story.
I hope they come together and choose to rename the place, too. I don't really like the name Blizzard.
Oh, Blizzard will, I imagine, go back to being its own separate entity.
I just don't like the name.
Blizzard Entertainment? They're not going to change the name of Blizzard.
Well, they should.
It's been that name. That's legacy there. It's
I just hear name the name Blizzard, and I hate blizzards.
That's your fault.
I'm like, no, man, that's Blizzard's a horrible name.
Been around longer than you've been alive.
That's fine. I'll change my name.
Then you should do that.
All right.
Whatever makes you happy, man. fucking. Unions. Fire Smash Bros. Ultimate Tester will get $25,000 in Nintendo union busting settlement. This comes from Ethan Gock over at Kotaku. The Switch maker will also post union rights notices in one of its main offices. Just one. Nintendo and former game tester fired earlier this year have seemingly reached a settlement in a labor dispute that kicked off widespread allegations about bad working conditions at Mario Maker's U.S. office. Mackenzie Clifton, who worked on games like Super Smash Bros., will be paid $25,910 as a part of the agreement, while Nintendo will have to post notices in its offices informing employees to the right to unionize. A settlement agreement was announced on the National Labor Relations Board website on Wednesday, a copy of which was obtained by Kotaku via Freedom of Information Act request. The $25,910 with interest will be paid out through Aston Carter, one of the hiring agencies Nintendo uses to staff its testing center and other departments of its Redmond, Washington, North American headquarters. Meanwhile, Nintendo will also have to post the following notice outside of the main entrance of the product testing department, where games like Breath of the Wild and Splatoon 3 are checked for bugs on release. And you have to print out basically saying it's your right to unionize, and then basically that this company will have to recognize unions and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So this is a good story of, I mean, yeah, it sucks that somebody had to get fired and stuff like that.
Right.
And like earlier this year, how much do you get? Is $25,000 the equivalent of your yearly salary, or is that like, is that how much money you would have missed in that couple of months? Is that worth it to you in the long run? I mean, $25,000 is a lot of money.
Right.
But also, like, your name is out there.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, you could be... There's always... I mean, even with the sexual allegation things and stuff like that, you could be barred from the industry as a troublemaker.
Yeah.
Or whatever, like... People won't outright say that, but people could look up your name and be like, oh shit, this person was tied to this lawsuit or this public complaint or whatever, and that company could be like, yeah, we don't want to hire this person because they talk too much, which is always a scary thing, and it makes these kinds of things hard to stand up for yourself, so it's really nice to see that somebody actually got their due out of it, and Nintendo was made an example of, which it doesn't happen often with Nintendo.
Right.
I was listening to a podcast about the original lawsuit of Gloopy or whatever, who made the Game Genie back in the day, and Nintendo tried to sue them, and that company won.
Right.
And it was Jeff Gerstmann and his buddy do a podcast talking through history, and his buddy was actually the lead witness on that case to defend against Gloopy.
That's cool.
And the Game Genie, so that he is the reason why Nintendo lost that lawsuit. It's super interesting. And yeah, Nintendo loves to sue people as well.
Yeah.
Nintendo, there's almost at least once a quarter is there's an article of Nintendo took down this weird fan site thing, this or mod from 10 years ago.
Yeah.
And it's now suing the creator of it. I mean,
they're so powerful, they can just like smite the.
Yeah, I mean, so what's even another interesting thing, especially about the Redmond office, is that Redmond office is basically just the hub for lawyers. Like, the treehouse is there.
Yeah.
And there's some games being worked on and tested and stuff and localized. But, like, American lawyers, that's the home.
That's, like, where they work out at the Capitol.
There's, like, most of that office is dudes in suits.
Wow. That must be weird.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's super interesting because that's also where they do, like, the directs and film the directs and stuff.
Right.
Very interesting place. The Redmond office is super interesting. Mega 64 did a video where they got to walk around the office and stuff like that in one of their sketches.
That's cool.
Yeah. Yeah, so that story is a little bit better and lighthearted. I really hope that the Activision thing works out for these women and they also get their due.
Yeah.
And they're able to work a fulfilling life in the games industry after. Hopefully this person as well. I clicked away from the article, so I don't have their name in front of me anymore. But yeah, the union. Yeah, you know, fucking video games, dude. We're all people.
Yeah, making that's games. All right. If you know who wrote it, drop their name in the comments. Tag them.
I said their name earlier.
Yeah.
Anyways, next thing is
the good news.
Yeah, these are all good news stories. These are all kind of nothing articles, but Sonic got a new trailer.
The game?
Yeah, the new Sonic Frontiers game.
Okay.
They showed off combat. It looks good.
All right.
Oh, it looks better than I thought it would be.
Yeah.
I don't know. Get a little reaction to that.
Yeah, because the second movie's coming out too, right?
The second movie's been out.
Has it been out? Wow. I don't even know.
The second movie came out last year.
Wow. I didn't even know the first movie's been out that long.
Yeah, Sonic trailer, new combat trailer. It looks nice. I don't know. This combat looks fun. I'm excited for it. It's very, very Bayonetta or Devil May Cry-esque. Very jump up, do a whole bunch of combos.
Yeah, it looks, looks a lot smoother than...
Yeah, I think the last time we saw this, it was running on Switch.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I'd imagine this is the PC version. But yeah, I don't know. Open Zone Sonic. Big boss fights like this. It's kind of Soulsy.
Yeah.
I don't know. The combat seems interesting. I like the movement a lot.
It is nice. It's definitely a huge twist on Sonic. That's cool.
Yeah.
And just hopefully, like, you know, you feel really fluid the whole time. Because that's, of course, the biggest thing with Sonic is you want to just...
Yeah.
Gotta go.
I want it to feel fluid but precise. And that's what I'm scared of, is that it could be fluid, but like water likes to go everywhere.
Right.
So I definitely want a preciseness to it. If I have like, I want that honing missile to feel like a pinpoint, you know? So,
yeah.
So hopefully we can get there. But it comes out soon. I think it's November, right? I'll go to the end. They showed the box art in this too.
November 8th. Nice.
It is coming to everything. That was just the PlayStation trailer.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know if I'll ever actually play it unless it's on Game Pass.
Yeah. But yeah. Exactly.
I mean, Sonic heads are probably all about it. You know what I'm saying? Like, they got their hair spiked up already. Like.
Yeah.
They got their sneakers laced. They're ready to go. But me personally, I'm just like, well, I mean, I know what Sonic does. He runs. He has to save. What does he do, really, though? Like, is he's not saving a princess. He's just collecting lots of rings.
He's collecting.
He has lots of friends.
The Chaos Emeralds.
Oh, okay. So I don't.
Oh, because Dr. Robotnik is trying to also collect the Chaos Emeralds to take over the world.
Oh, okay.
Or something like that. I'm not a huge Sonic fan.
It's kind of like Crash Bandicoot.
Yes. Yes. But before Crash Bandicoot.
Right, of course. Yeah, yeah.
That's cool. I had it up for a second, and then it fucking clicked away. Yeah, it looks cool. Starfield.
Oh, this Starfield. Guy. Starfield.
Todd Howard talks Starfield's hard sci-fi approach in new developer video. This comes from Eurogamer by Matt Wells. With Starfield's hugely anticipated 2023 release growing ever closer, Bethesda has launched a new Q&A video series, and Episode 1 sees director Todd Howard responding to a number of community queries, including sharing some thoughts on traits, dialogue, and whether Starfield can be described as a hard sci-fi game. Whatever the fuck that means.
Hard sci-fi. Dude, you know,
Fallout,
like,
is hard sci-fi.
You have...
What the fuck?
Your soft sci-fi. And then you have your hard sci-fi.
Even fucking Elder Scrolls has hard sci-fi shit. Of course Starfield is hard. The space game is hard sci-fi.
Does it mean, like, difficulty hard or, like...
No.
Like, swagged out?
No, genre specific. Like, this is sci-fi. It's aliens and stuff.
Right.
But it's grounded reality. Hard sci-fi, it would be, like, fucking Star Trek. Or something like that.
Okay.
Of course it's hard sci-fi.
Right.
You're in a spaceship.
Yeah, what's the name?
Starfield.
Right, there you go. Like that. You don't have to tell me.
Stupid question. Howard began the chat by detailing a few of Starfield's inspirations: 1984, Space Sim, Sundog, Frozen Legacy, and pen and paper RPG Traveler. If you're wondering before moving on to tackle the hard sci-fi question, this, he said, was a little tricky to answer insofar as different people will likely have different definitions of hard sci-fi. Okay. Sure. The big thing I wanted from this, though, is this quote right here. This is about the scope of the game and, like, dialogue and everything like that. The scope of the game, the amount of content that we're making, is a bit more than we've done before in terms of quests and things like that, he added. With the dialogue, we just passed 250,000 lines. By comparison, Fallout 4 is to have featured 111,000 lines of dialogue, while Skyrim included 60,000. That's a lot of dialogue, Howard continued. but we've gone through it and the impact is really there. And that includes my favorite speech persuasion system. It feels like it's a part of the dialogue, but you're spending points to persuade them. Feels natural, not like I've entered some other mode when I'm not doing regular dialogue. So, a lot of old Fallout games and stuff like that, when you play, you have, like, dialogue trees and stuff like that. I mean, I guess this is just an RPG staple now.
Yeah.
And then you'll have, like, one that's, like, you're lying, or one to persuade, or...
Right, one you can't do yet because you're not skilled enough or something.
Yeah, well, Fallout will always let you do it.
Right, but you're just probably going to fail.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's
not recommended.
This is that quote. And here it is, an example. Cool. Okay, so you do have a plus one plus. So that's interesting. So you'll go into the perk dialogue, and then I'll give you 5 different examples of that. That's really cool. That's cool.
It makes it a little more, yeah, like, branched out. Like, you don't feel so robotic or limited.
Yeah.
'Cause it's more like, I guess not personality-based, but you can be a little more personable, maybe.
Yeah. Interesting.
That's cool. I mean, is that... What else, though?
Yeah. Well, the game got delayed till next year, so...
Great. I mean, I'm glad that I can talk to these people a little bit better.
Right. I'm pretty sure it got delayed till next year. Starfield release date. It was supposed to come out... Yeah, it got delayed until... First half of 2023. It was supposed to come out 11/11. Like Skyrim did. Yes. Starfield is set to launch in the first half of 2023 exclusively to PC and Xbox Series X via Game Pass. Sweet by Bethesda, we're going to have to wait a little longer than previously announced release date of November 11th, 2022. Cool. On to the next story, because that was also another story. A lot of these stories are nothing, kind of just like shit happened and people commenting on it.
Yeah.
But we got another Pokemon trailer.
Okay.
With another reveal.
Another new Pokemon.
Another new Pokemon and a new gym leader.
Oh, okay.
I haven't seen it yet. This came out earlier today.
Nice. So
I was excited because it seems like every single podcast there's something new.
Belly Bolt.
Hell yeah. Let's pop on the headphones.
You know what? If you would have told me the name before I saw it, I would have guessed that it was a fat Pokemon. And it's probably like an electric type.
Oh, yeah.
Belly Bolt? Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's electric.
Right on the mic. Look at this jacket, though. I want that jacket. That's pretty cool. My eyeballs are mine.
Gym leader. I'm glad gyms are back too.
Heck yeah, you got this like 80s synth pop.
Oh yeah. She has like Magnemites in her hair?
Heck yeah. She's not even using them. She's just like, these are just the core Pokemon.
Yeah. They're like baby Magnemites.
Oh wow. An Irish Pokemon?
Yeah.
Boy, give me my Guinness. Gotta shock some Pokemon.
I think that might be where these games were set.
That would make sense with the sheep and the... Maybe not the giraffes, but the sheep and the other things that have come out.
Yeah, and the dragon type.
Yeah.
Loch Ness monster.
Right, and they love motorcycles.
I didn't feel like it announced anything in that. I feel like it... We'll bring up the long-ass GameSpot trailer. Yeah, turtles as well.
Yeah.
The crabs. The last game took place in the UK. Or their version of the UK. There we go. She's a streamer.
Hey, belly ball, you think they could throw some, like, zigzags in there or something?
What?
It's an electric... Oh, that's his... I didn't realize that was his, Oh, that's his nose. But they look like little eyeballs. Like he
does have eyeballs.
Yeah. He's very shiny, though.
Yeah. Why is he so shiny? I guess props are like,
Well, that's cool.
Yeah. New gym leader. I'm excited for gyms and stuff like that. We got one more story. Gyms. Run it off with one more story. This will be a shorter episode. It's not bad. Not too bad. One more story is that Street Fighter 6, the closed beta, or open beta, or whatever it was this week. People really like it a lot.
Really?
And I'm kind of interested.
I don't think I've seen it yet.
Kind of interesting.
TBH. I just remember the hint from, or not the hint, this is coming eventually from a long time ago.
They announced it. The end of last year?
Yeah.
I don't know, the Game Awards?
I think that's the last
time. And then people were like, the logo looks really bad. And then they changed the logo.
Well, that's and good.
And revealed a whole bunch of characters and stuff. Here. I got an article right here. Street Fighter 6 is a fighting dream. You can take off that now. Street Fighter 6 is a fighting game dream. Or a fighting game newcomer's dream. Can't fucking read. It was short, but Street Fighter 6 closed beta test was sweet. Wrapping up earlier today, the beta gave a solid look into the future of an iconic gaming franchise. There's a lot to like, including the depth of the new avatar creator, which people are making horrible monstrosities.
I have seen that. That is hilarious. Some of the things that have already, like people made characters that look like actual penises, and I thought that was just the best. That's so funny.
So there's a lot of really gross shit that people can make.
Yeah.
It's cool. It's great. But the best part, aside from learning character matchups and mastering your favorite fighter, is how approachable the mechanics were. No lie, this might be the most successful Street Fighter Capcom has made thus far.
Nice.
And one actively attempts to teach you its systems.
Oh, yeah.
Running from October 7th through the 10th, the closed beta test had quite a few offerings. Alongside the training mode were casual and ranked online matches, as well as access to the cursed character creator and in-game shops in the Battle Hub central area to buy clothes for your avatar. It was surprisingly robust, letting you test out several fighters, spectate matches by walking up to the arcade cabinets in the hub world, and emote with iconic moves like Guile's Somersault Kick and Ryu's Hadouken. The main attraction of the beta, though, was absolutely the new fighting game mechanics. Fighting games are notorious for having high barriers to entry, baiting attacks, chain grabs, empty jumps, so on. The glossary of terminology to comprehend if you want to have a fighting chance online is staggering. Street Fighter VI has all of this, of course, but it does not concern itself with bogging you down with its minutia. Instead, the beta threw you right into the action, and it gave you a choice between two control schemes. The original classic controls for hardcore fans.
Nice.
And a modern controls for beginners that allows assisted combos and easier specials.
Nice.
There's a handful of characters, including mainstays like Chun-Li and newcomers such as Luke, and passionately screamed fight as you were toe-to-toe with players online. Okay. That alone, breaking down with the intimidating walls while ensuring there's still room for challenge, solidifies Street Fighter 6 ethos. It wants to be for everyone, and so far makes some great strides in hitting that mark.
I mean, it looks great.
Yeah. I'm really excited for it. So you have, there's two different mechanics, fighting game styles. It's a chunk and hard, that resolution.
Yeah. It looks like you can just, like, challenge people in the streets to fight. Like, yes. Other players, which is, like...
No. No, so all the online stuff is in this battle hub, right?
Oh, okay.
There is a open world single player story.
Oh.
That we have not seen yet.
Okay.
We've only seen in trailers and stuff like that.
Wow.
So there's a whole nother part of this game we have not seen. But yeah, if you wanted to go up and watch someone play, you just go up to one of these arcade cabinets and watch. There's the giant ranked matches on screen.
That's crazy.
And stuff like that. Also on those arcade cabinets, they will have old Capcom games on them that will be rotating. So like, while the beta was live, they had Street Fighter 2 on there. They had another Capcom game. I can't remember.
Whatever this is.
That is an homage to the original Street Fighter.
Oh, where you beat up the car?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you're beating up an 18-wheeler.
Yeah. Why not? That's incredible, though. That's super exciting, to be honest. Like.
Yeah, this game looks great.
Wow. And I haven't played a fighting game in a while, just because they did become kind of, like, all the same. Like, no matter who made a game, I mean, sure, you know, you can... You got the Mortal Kombat, and each one that comes out, they are able to make the bones even more fragmented. Like, at this point, it's like, you know, they went from breaking bones to, like, how much dust can we create from the bones? Like, you can only kill someone so many times, you know?
Yeah. I played a little bit of 11. I liked 11 a lot.
I liked it. And the story's funny and cool and, like, you know, I'm a fan. I've always been a fan. But it's, like, it all does become, like,
Mortal Kombat.
The Injustice games and all those.
Like, Injustice become... wasn't my thing. I played a little bit of one, the first one, but it wasn't my thing. But at that point, I was definitely feeling the fatigue, especially Mortal Kombat 10. I was like, this is, like, really heavy feeling. I don't know if I really want this right now.
Yeah.
There hasn't been a new Tekken in a very long time.
Right. Even the latest Soul Calibur, I wasn't, like, super feeling
Soul Calibur
it.
Wasn't feeling either.
And I really liked Soul Calibur.
Yeah,
like
first ones. I like Soul Calibur back in the day. I've never been into Virtua Fighter or anything like that, which is the other fighting game series that people like. Is that also Capcom? Virtua Fighter? That might be Sega.
I don't know if I played that one.
That is Dead or Alive. Yeah, so that would be Sega. It's okay. Virtual Fighter's okay. People really like Virtual Fighter. It was a big deal back in the day because it was one of the best looking fighting games, and that's kind of like where they've always made their mark over the years up until 5. I think 5 came out on the 360. But just graphics, high fidelity, like, let's make these characters look as real as possible. Let's make this world look as real as possible.
Word.
Kind of pushing that boundary. But as graphics and tech got better, those games kind of started looking more and more similar.
Mm-hmm.
And they couldn't push the bar as far, so I think that kind of, along with, there's also other really good fighting games.
Yeah.
People like this a lot more. But Virtua Fighter will always have its spot. They remastered Virtua Fighter 2 recently. And people were happy with that.
That's cool too. Little remix on the rules.
Yes. Yeah. Like, path trying to keep the ball up and stuff like that.
Right. Yeah.
I really like that. These cool little things.
Adds little, yeah. Makes it kind of a Smash Brothery.
Yeah.
The little, not gimmicks, but, like, you know, little extra mini things.
That's another thing. Like, a lot of these characters have a lot of weird little gimmicks and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Like, there's the Drunken Master where you, like, try to sips in between every single attack and just try to, you have to, the more sips you take through the match, the stronger you get.
Yeah.
So,
that's cool.
Yeah, I think you try to get like up to 10 sips or something like that within your match and like fucking rip shit.
Yeah, he was one of my favorites. Here comes the commentator.
Yeah, so that's another thing they added is that it has they have AI commentating.
Yeah.
Of like real commentators. So you have like famous esports commentators all commentating live play-by-plays to these games.
Interesting.
And you can interchange, like, different...
Like, who's saying what?
Who's saying what.
Okay.
Like, you have your main dude and you have your hype man dude.
Right.
They're both talking. You can have a Japanese dude and an English dude talking.
Nice.
Or, like, Jeff Gerstmann had Demon Dude talking on one end and then had fucking, like, Sonic Fox or whoever like talking on the other end, and it was like one dude talking in Japanese and then the other dude like responding like, yeah dude.
That's funny.
Yeah, it was really, really cool. I'm super interested in this game. The more I see about it, the more intrigued I am.
Wow. Yeah. Especially, no, they really have put so much more than I expected in like a side scrolling fighting game, you
know? Yeah.
A lot. They put a lot.
And it's going to be a lot more than a side-scrolling fighting game.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's already so much open world and stuff.
Yeah, it's like, almost like a third person beat 'em up at times, which like the original Street Fighter was a beat 'em up.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like more going to those roots in some cases too, which is cool. That's give me cool, it all. Yeah. Put it all in there. Give me all the game mechanics.
Right, since. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I'm excited.
It has that like GTA vibe too, that like, because it's like, oh, now they're showing all that.
He had the Jeremy Vicious Lopez along with the demon dude.
Nice.
Yeah. The dog's barking outside. Ready to come in.
Yeah, this is cool.
Yeah, I'm really excited. You train with Chun-Li or... Yeah. Fuck yeah, dude. Character creator. Hell yeah. Well, that's all I have for today's episode, Patrick. It's a shorter podcast. We had 9 news stories, and we got through that pretty fast.
Yeah, they weren't super grand or anything, no, for the most part.
Basically
so.
Opinions, and then right. Like a couple of actual heavy news stories. But yeah, there wasn't a lot of news coming out other than legal stuff. Maybe next week. Who knows? Maybe next
Shredded.
Week.
Shredded.
New showcase or whatever. That's what takes the most amount of time is coming through.
Coming
this.
Up with the characters stuff.
Yeah, I love the especially how detailed it is too. Like, there's such an in depth like everything.
Yeah, I can't wait till people start recreating characters.
Yes.
And they start releasing those. Like that's when they did that with like the Fallout character creator and stuff. Like that, those are always my favorite when people remake.
Yeah, so they're gonna have a spot where you can face each other's creative characters, but in actual ranked matches, it seems like that. You're gonna only have like the mainstays fighting.
Yeah.
Like that's where you're gonna see Ryu and Ken and Chun-Li and fucking what's his name? Green dude. I always want to call him Tonka Truck because that's what his name reminds me of.
Right.
But yeah, I froze this monster earlier and that was just a giant ice block in the middle.
Nice.
Yeah. That's all I have for this week. We talked about games. We talked about news. Anything else? Anything else you want to add before we leave? Before we forget anything?
Not really.
Word. Well, before I close it out, I will do the housekeeping because I didn't do it at the top of the show of all of our socials are down below. Go, you know, follow us on all that stuff. Like, comment, and subscribe, of course. And down below, there's also the Cash App to donate to the channel if you want to support, you know, the podcast or the Let's Plays that I do. Like I said, every single time that I play video games, it's all recorded. So if you want to see me play Elden Ring, Outlast, or anything down, my Resident Evil 7 playthrough or 8 playthrough, those are all on here. There's 900 videos that you need to go watch.
Starting now.
4 years of content. Yeah, dude. Also, the other thing is that the Pokemon store is down below, so if you like Pokemon cards and you also want to see me open cards on the channel, those videos are down below. Or not down below, but on the channel. But the cards that I've opened on the channel are sold on that Pokemon store. So you can go there and buy some cards. Also, I've put a bunch of my personal collection up. So go buy some things. There's some cool things out there. And that being said, guys, it's been fun. It's been real. Peace out, Cubs.
See ya.
Bye.